Hello, my name's Guy de la Bedoyere. I'm a British historian who specialises in the Roman world, and I've written a number of books on the subject. And today I'm going to talk to you about my book, Domina, The Women Who Made Imperial Rome. It's published by Yale University Press in autumn 2018. I found it absolutely fascinating to write, and I'd like to explain a little bit about how I got the idea and what I was trying to do. I think we've all heard of the first five Roman emperors, haven't we? Augustus, Tiberius, Caligula, Claudius and Nero. The members of the Julio-Claudian dynasty lasted about a century, from 27 BC to AD 68. The remarkable fact is, though, that the only reason that dynasty survived at all, or even existed, was because of the female bloodline. Now, there have been a lot of books written on Roman empresses and a lot written about that period, but no one really seems to have fixed on that remarkable fact, the dependence on the female bloodline. If you go right back to the beginning, let's look at how it started. Augustus became effectively emperor in 27 BC. That's when he took the name Augustus. 4 years before, he defeated Mark Antony and Cleopatra in 31 BC. That brought the Republic to the end, to its end. It ended the Civil War, and Augustus pretended to everybody that he'd restored the Republic, but the truth is he'd really established a monarchy, but he spent a lot of time trying to disguise that. His official name, before he became Augustus, was Gaius Julius Caesar, and that's because he was Julius Caesar's heir. He was, in fact, the son of Julius Caesar's niece, Attia. And when Caesar was assassinated in 44 BC, when his will was read, he'd made who was then the young Octavian into his heir, and Octavian became Gaius Julius Caesar and ultimately Augustus. So we can see right from the outset there's already a female transmission. Once he's in power, although Augustus is trying to tell everybody he's restored the Republic, the reality is, as I said, it's a monarchy in all but name. And like any mob family head, what he wants to do is to keep all that power within the family. So that means finding an heir. But he's got a problem from the outset. He doesn't have a son. Not least, there isn't even a system for a succession. So he has to fabricate some route. And what he does is he takes his daughter Julia, who, later called Julia the Elder, who is the only child Augustus ever has, by his first wife Scribonia, and he marries her to his sister Octavia's son Marcellus. And Marcellus then effectively becomes Augustus's heir. That's a great plan, except that Marcellus dies as a very young man. So that's kiboshed. And so what Augustus has to do next is he marries his general, Agrippa, Marcus Agrippa, who'd been such a big part of Augustus' success. He marries him to Julia, and they have a number of children, including two boys called Gaius and Lucius, and Augustus is captivated. He loves them. He adores them. He makes them into his, he adopts them as his sons, and they're going to become his heirs. Unfortunately, they peg it as young men. They're gone too. In the end, Augustus had to turn to his wife Livia, his empress, a very powerful, dominating and successful figure. And incidentally, I'd like to point out, essentially the only one of these women who is going to die in her bed. Livia has a son called Tiberius. Tiberius then is adopted as Augustus's heir and succeeds him in the year 14. Not Augustus's first choice at all, even though Tiberius was a very experienced politician and general. To cut a long story short, Tiberius's reign is completely dominated, at least for the first part until his mother's death, by Livia. Livia and her so-called machinations. Because Livia has got a very clear sense of power, but she knows, like so many of these women, that the only way she can operate that in the Roman world is through a man. So she does all her interweaving of power, all her manipulation of situations through Tiberius, much to his eternal frustration. However, she's long gone by the time he dies in 37, and what he has to do is pass the throne on to his great-nephew Caligula. Caligula was in fact Augustus's great-grandson, because Caligula's mother, Agrippina the Elder, was the daughter of Augustus's daughter Julia. And that's terrific. He's got a stellar lineage right from the outset. He's also descended from Octavia, and he's also descended from Livia through his father Germanicus, the great general, who had died a number of years before out in Syria. So Caligula is welcomed to the throne by the mob and the army alike. They're absolutely delighted, but it all goes rather wrong for him because he loses his marbles. He's too young. He can't cope with the power. He ends up being assassinated in the year 41. What happens then? The army passes the throne to his uncle Claudius, Germanicus's brother. Claudius is already married to a woman called Messalina. Messalina was herself descended from Octavia. Claudius is only descended from Octavia and also from Livia. So they don't have an absolutely ideal lineage, but it'll do for the moment because Claudius is really the only eligible person around at the time. Now, we have an emperor again. It's the year 41. Claudius is on the throne with Messalina. He has to prove himself, but he's also aware that he does have a little bit of a dynastic issue. He has children by Messalina, but there's always going to be an issue about them because things go very wrong. Messalina is accused of all sorts of reckless infidelities, including bigamous marriages, and eventually Claudius has to have her executed. At that point, in an extraordinary twist in the story, he turns to his niece, Agrippina the Younger, Agrippina the Elder's daughter and sister of Caligula. Now, Agrippina the Younger is a truly remarkable figure. She is probably the most intelligent of all the Julio-Claudians, male or female. She is a past master at manipulating situations. She engages in an absolute determination to get supreme power for herself and to see her son Nero, by a previous marriage, become emperor after Claudius. And Nero, of course, like his mother, shares that descent from Augustus and also from Octavia and also from Livia. And in fact, this tetradram, this large silver coin struck in the city of Ephesus in Asia Minor. It features Claudius on it, and his bust is overlaid with that of Agrippina the Younger. It's really this is unprecedented. This has never happened before in the Roman world, and it's never going to happen again. They look like joint monarchs, and it's a mark of just how powerful Agrippina had become that she could get herself into this position. She manages to sideline Claudius's children. She gets her son Nero named as the heir, and in the year 54 she sees to it that Claudius dies and her son Nero becomes emperor. And that whole period, really, from when she marries Claudius right the way through for the first 5 years of Nero's reign, you could see that really as the reign of Agrippina the Younger, rather than that of Claudius and Nero, because she's the one who's really in control. But Agrippina is trapped in this extremely prejudiced Roman world. It's a man's world. Women are not supposed to have power. They don't have any official power. In a sense, that advantages them because it also means they're not constrained by the system. So they can act with a relative amount of impunity in certain contexts. But when it comes to officialdom, it's useless being a woman. You can't be an empress in your own right. So the only way Agrippina can wield power is firstly through Claudius and then through Nero. But Nero was a teenage boy. And as he gets a little bit older, he becomes extremely frustrated by his mother's attempts to control him, which is why in 59 he negotiates with people to murder her. And he has her killed. And then she's out of the way. And from that point on, Nero is really out of control. The dynasty collapses with him in 68. He has, in later years, married a woman called Poppaea, who is bearing his child, but he kicks her to death in a fit of rage when she tells him off for going to the circuses too much. In the end, Nero is effectively obliged to commit suicide, and the Julio-Claudian dynasty comes to an end. Now, when I was writing this book, one of the great challenges was trying to find out really what these women did, were like, and what they were up to. There's so many conflicting pieces of evidence about them, not least because the Roman historians were very locked into the idea that women were one thing or the other. They were either venerated Roman matrons, the absolute embodiment of goodness and purity, all built around this concept of pudicitia. That's to do with a woman's virtue, her sexual chastity. It can be applied to men as well, incidentally, but pudicitia was something so fragile that a woman could lose it easily, but really that was the great aspiration, that a woman should have immaculate pudicitia. And the Roman historians also effortlessly subscribe to the idea of women as destabilizing influences because of their inclination to be over-emotional and out of control. So the Roman historians love this idea of a complete contrast of identities, and they are absolutely fixated with this. Now, this means that women are used as rhetorical devices all the time, as symbols of evil, of things going wrong, of undermining the state, and that is exactly exactly how Agrippina the Younger is relentlessly depicted by the Roman historian Tacitus. Tacitus also paints a picture of Livia as a ruthless machinator who made sure that all sorts of people were killed and pushed out of the way to ensure that it's her descendants who are on the throne of Rome. Now, this makes for an extremely interesting story, and we've got a whole raft of remarkable aspects to these women's lives. Julia the Elder, who was such a fundamental and important dynastic figure, she in the end can't bear the position she's put into. She is alleged to have become chronically unfaithful to her husband and to her family, and she ends up being exiled and totally shamed. Her daughter Agrippina the Elder, on the other hand, is held up as a paragon of virtue, as the ultimate Roman wife and matron who'd had lots of children and been a great wife to her husband Germanicus. Agrippina the Younger is depicted as a terrible figure, somebody who was absolutely merciless in her exploitation of circumstances. And then along that we've got Messalina, Claudius's first wife, who he, as I said, he has to execute for her sister infidelities, and she becomes almost a watchword for being a bad girl. Similarly, Poppaea, Nero's wife, the last empress that he had, Poppaea is depicted as a cheerleader for total self-indulgence and ambition. This makes for a really remarkable story of this first century of the Roman world, and I found it completely fascinating trying to find out how these women waded their way through, how they exerted control, how they functioned within the political system and without it at the same time. It's a remarkable story of intrigue and dissension, of illicit killings, of all sorts of things going on. And in the end, the dynasty came to an end. But if you jump on 150 years later, there's a remarkable revival. The second longest dynasty in Roman history starts with the Emperor Septimius Severus in 193 when he takes control. The only reason it lasts at all the way through to the year 235 with a relative called Severus Alexander is through the female line. You have a whole succession of Syrian empresses who, starting with Septimius Severus' wife Julia Domna, and her sister Julia Maesa, and they, Maesa and her daughters, Soemius and Mamia, they managed to stay in a remarkable amount of control because they operate through male figures in the dynasty. And they play the same gamble, and they end up, just like Agrippina the Younger, losing as well. It shows you how the Roman world worked. It was utterly a man's world, but it is an extraordinary testament to these women that they had so much influence on affairs. They were the figures through whom the dynasty operated at all. They found out how to assert themselves within the Roman world as far as they can, but they were always playing a terrible gamble. In the end, most of them paid the same price that most of the male figures played too. It's an amazing story. And if you choose to read the book, you can get it on Amazon. And I really hope you enjoy reading it as much as I did writing it. Thank you.